Good morning, everybody. I am Professor Feliziani from University of L'Aquila. I will present EMC and EMF issues in near-field wireless power transfer system. My talk has been prepared in cooperation with other my colleagues, Tommaso Campi, Silvano Cruciani e Francesca Maradei. This is the outline of my talk. I will give an introduction of a near-field WPT system based on inductive coupling, which is an intentional source of a strong magnetic field. Then, I will present stationary and dynamic WPT systems for automotive applications with the related EMC and EMF safety standards. After, I will illustrate how we can predict the magnetic field in the environment and the electric field inside the human body. I will also present possible interference in implanted biomedical devices during wireless charging. Finally, I will present you some mitigation techniques to reduce the magnetic fields produced by the WPT coils without reducing the electrical performance of the WPT system. And I will jump to the conclusions. The near-field WPT is based on Faraday's law of induction. In the picture, you can see two coupled coils, which are separated by an air gap. The first coil is named as primary or transmitting coil, while the second coil is named as secondary or receiving coil. The WPT functioning is similar to that of an electrical transformer, but with a very high magnetic flux leakage due to the presence of an air gap that leads to a low coupling factor between coils. Then, to improve the WPT performance, the system is resonated by introducing two capacitors to compensate the inductive reactance of the coils, as you can see in the equivalent circuit with the series-series compensation topology. Applications of WPT technology are depicted in this slide, where you can see that there are many applications not yet in the market to recharge batteries of electrical vehicles, implanted biomedical devices, consumer electronics, and drones. The power level starts at less than 1 watt for biomedical devices, up to 1 megawatt for a train. The train was an important experiment carried out in Korea. The frequency range is normally between few kilohertz to few megahertz, but automotive applications are generally in the frequency range between 20 and 100 kilohertz. 85 kilohertz are used for light medium duty vehicles, while 20 or 60 kilohertz were used in some experiments of high duty vehicles. Currently, there are two main methods to recharge the battery of an electric vehicle: plug-in charging and wireless charging. In wireless charging, the receiver is mounted on the vehicle and the transmitter is mounted on the road. The wireless charging is safer and more comfortable for the driver than conductive charging, even if the efficiency is lower. Wireless charging is divided in two categories: stationary wireless charging with stopped vehicles in charging station, or dynamic wireless charging with vehicles in motion. The first technology is quite ready to be introduced in the market, while the second one is for the future. It is worth noting that the WPT technology plays a key role in the development of autonomous driving systems. In a stationary WPT system, the battery charging takes place only when the vehicle is stopped in a charging station, in a parking, in a garage, etc. There is only one transmitter mounted on the ground floor. The receiver is on the vehicle. The overall efficiency from AC to DC can be more than 90%, but the vehicle must remain stopped for a long time, like plug-in charging. The flow chart diagram is depicted in the figure. The transmitter is named as ground assembly, GA, while the receiver is named as vehicle assembly, VA. The transmitter is powered by the AC grid and transforms the power frequency in high frequency via electronics devices as boost converter and inverter. The GA coil is coupled with VA coil by inductive coupling. In the VA, the high frequency is rectified to recharge the onboard battery. The coil's inductors are fully compensated and resonate. In dynamic WPT systems, the charging process takes place when the vehicle is in motion. To this aim, multiple transmitting coil or rails are mounted on the ground. It implies that the rod must be electrified. The big advantage of this future technology is given by the wireless charging when the vehicle is in motion. It leads to a reduction of battery capacity and weight. Ideally, the driving range can be quite infinite, as other electrified transportation systems like trains. This big range and autonomy from the propeller is perfect for the autonomous driving system project. The main disadvantages are given by the high cost of the road infrastructure and by the EMC and the EMF safety issues due to the magnetic field in the environment. Another disadvantage is given by the battery charging efficiency that is lower than that of stationary WPT systems. There are many issues of EMC and EMF safety in automotive WPT systems because electric vehicles will be widely used in the future, and it is well known that WPT systems produce strong magnetic fields. Therefore, there is a big concern for the future that exposure to magnetic fields due to the electrification of road transport may cause adverse health effects. Magnetic field can interfere with electrical and electronic systems in the vehicles and the road infrastructure. This topic is very challenging for the future. There are several standards for WPT automotive. The main standards are ISO 19363, IEC 61980 and SAE J2954. This last standard defines the main configuration of stationary WPT systems for automotive that guarantees interoperability between different vehicles and different charging stations. The main definitions are: the nominal frequency is fixed to 85 kHz with some tolerance. The power levels are 4, 3.7, 7.7, 11, and 22 kV-ampere. There are also three zeta classes for vertical separation between the ground assembly mounted on the ground and the vehicle assembly mounted on board of the vehicle. There are also some specifications for coil topology and maximum admissible offset between coils. As regards dynamic WPT systems, they may be considered in the future based on industry feedback. EMC standards for WPT automotive can be divided in EMC component testing and vehicle level EMC testing. Component level tests should be performed before integration into vehicle system. The component testing is quite traditional, while the EMC level testing is not yet standardized. A proposal was presented for the WPT radiator field limits fixed to 100 dB microampere per meter at 85 kHz. Electromagnetic field safety standards are the 1998 and 2010 ICNIRP guidelines for general public. The new 2020 ACNERP guideline starts at 100 kHz as minimum frequency, and therefore it cannot be applied to WPT automotive systems. ICNIRP fixes two kinds of limits: reference levels and basic restrictions. Limitations of exposures that are based on physical quantities directly related to the established health effects are termed basic restrictions. Reference levels of exposures are provided for comparison with measured values of physical quantities. Reference levels are measurable quantities, while basic restrictions are physical quantities inside the human body. It means that they can be measured only in phantoms or obtained by simulation. Compliance with all reference levels will ensure compliance with basic restrictions. For the considered WPT application, the reference level is the external magnetic field, while the basic restrictions are the current density in CNIRP 1998 and the internal electric field in CNIRP 2010. The recent 2019 IEEE standard C95.1 for EMF safety adopts a new terminology. The restricted environment is equivalent to general public in CNIRP guidelines. The exposure reference levels are reference levels in CNIRP, and dosimetric reference levels are the basic restrictions in CNIRP. The dosimetric reference level is the in situ electric field. It should be noted that in the European Union, the low frequency limits are regulated from 1999 by council recommendations, and the limits are taken from CNIRP 1998. It implies that the compliance with both 1998 and 2010 CNIRP regulations is often required in some European countries. Finally, it should be noted that the 2019 IEEE standard is less restrictive than CNIRP guidelines, at least 85 kHz. In this slide, the limits of CNIRP guidelines are reported. The reference levels are given in terms of magnetic flux induction, and they're equal to 6.25 microtesla for CNIRP 1998. And to 27 microtesla for ACNERP 2010. Also, the frequency ranges are different. The basic restrictions are referred to different physical quantities. Induced current for ACNERP 98 and internal electric field for ACNERP 2010. The limits at the frequency of 85 kHz are equal to 170 milliamps per square meter for CNIRP 98 and equal to 11.475 volt per meter for the internal electric field for the CNIRP 2010. SAR below 100 kHz is not considered in the regulations. It should be noted that CNIRP 2010 is much less restrictive than CNIRP 98, while CNIRP 2020 is not applicable. A near-field WPT system is based on Faraday's law of induction to two magnetic resonant coils. In this picture, you can see the primary coil, or transmitting coil, coupled to a secondary coil, or receiving coil. The system can be more complex with some electrical and electronics components. But to simplify the study, it is possible to arrive to an equivalent circuit with only analogical components. This part represents the coils with resistances to modulate losses and inductances. Key is the coupling factor. The inductive coils are weakly coupled, so the key factor is not so high. They work at resonance to improve the performances. Now I will present the electromagnetic field and dosimetric analysis. The main assumption is that the human body does not modify the magnetic field distribution produced by the coil currents at the frequency of 85 kHz. The human body is assumed to be transparent to the incident magnetic field, and the induced currents are too small to modify the magnetic field distribution. We propose a two-step calculation procedure. In the first step, the magnetic field is calculated without considering the presence of the human body. In the second step, the internal electric field is then calculated inside the human body, assuming as input the already calculated magnetic vector potential distribution. Magneto-quasi-static field equations are suitable to describe the considered problem at 85 kHz. The field equations can be solved in the frequency domain by the finite element method, FEM. The conductive parts of the vehicle, which are penetrable but being well discretized using a fine finite element mesh to accurately account the reflection and transmission of the field in the body shell. This is a critical point since the computational cost to model the skin effect in metallic parts of the vehicle can be very relevant. To overcome this issue, special numerical techniques can be used in commercial software tools. Now I will present the impedance network boundary conditions to model thin conductive shields. Considering a computational domain with a shield embedded in it, it is possible to eliminate the shield domain, introducing new boundary conditions on the shield surfaces. The tangential components of the electric and magnetic fields on both shield surfaces are related by transmission line equations, which can be modeled by a two-port network. This two-port network can be easily implemented in any commercial software tool based on finite element method. The artificial material single layer method. It is based on transmission line theory of shielding. It reduces the number of finite elements in the shielding region. It is very useful when the skin depth delta is lower than the shield thickness. Here is an example, a finite element mesh with a big discretization inside the conductive material. Applying the AMSL method, it is possible to use only one finite element in the direction of the propagation. But you have to modify the physical constant of this subdomain. The real physical constants are transformed in artificial constants. The AMCL implementation is straightforward. It's only necessary to generate an adequate FEM mesh and replace the physical constant with the artificial ones obtained by the AMCL method. These are the expressions for the artificial physical constants, where gamma is the propagation constant, d is the shield thickness, and eta is the intrinsic impedance of the shield. We have performed some tests for validation, and then you can see that the shielding effectiveness of a planar shield excited by plane wave field with normal incidence leads to very good results until some high frequency, when the AMSL method cannot be considered valid. AMSL method can be used for anisotropic material like carbon fiber reinforced polymer. It is composed by many plies. Each ply is given by some conductive fibers embedded in a dielectric matrix. A ply can be modeled as a thin layer of homogeneous anisotropic material at the considered frequencies using homogenization procedure. A multi-layer panel, like this, can be modeled by equivalent tensors via a series cascade of multi-port network. So at the end, we can obtain a tensor matrix for the conductivity and permittivity, which represent the multi-layer anisotropic panels. The material used to fabricate the vehicle body plays an important role to the magnetic field behavior. The vehicle body shell is typically made of a conductive material, steel or aluminium. In the future, the body shell will be made of carbon fiber reinforced polymer to reduce car weight and consumption. In this slide, you can see an experiment. There is a carbon fiber plate above a WPT coil system. We have measured the magnetic field above the plate for carbon fiber and aluminum. You can see that there are big differences. The magnetic field at 5 kHz is practically not attenuated by the presence of the carbon fiber plate. Therefore, EMC and EMF safety issues can be relevant inside the vehicle.